Today is the final day of our project that has been like 9 days. My name is Andrea Eliza Arnold. I'm a curator and also a film producer, and do quite a lot of cultural work myself and educational through art. We've been presenting the four films and one musical piece that we've been working on for this project of different objects that are here in this museum in the Pitt Rivers.
Coming, it's really lovely to see so many people here. Breathe is a Erasmus and Arts Council England funded program. The program aims to create spaces for talking about colonial histories, particularly between Europe and Africa, through African objects within museums. But more than that, Breathe also aims to facilitate connections between Black people and other people of color to reflect on those histories and those personal experiences, and also to shed light on the fact that colonization is not something of our past, but is something that continues and persists today.
This kind of international exchange is one aspect of the Breathe project. So it's happening in different cities, facilitating exchange between those different cities, between different organizations. The most important exchange that's happening is between the youth and young people that we are working with. So we are connecting the diasporic youth in different cities.
We have been working on mainly three objects of this museum. We started with the ivory tusk from the Benin kingdom. We also, the Ekpo mask from the Ibibio tribe, both are from the nowadays Nigeria, and the mbira from Zimbabwe. The result of this project, which you are here to see, are four films and one musical piece. The films are partly interviews with our facilitators, but more than that, they are also creative interpretations of the general knowledge that we gained through these days working here in the museum with the museum.
A lot of my work involves bringing people from the local community, international community, together to look at the collections, activate the collections, create this intercultural dialogue, and really bring new stories to the collections that we have here. We have over 500,000 in the museum, and there's certainly a lot of work to be done. At the moment, ongoing work relating to African collections, there's a couple of projects. I worked on the Living Cultures project with Grace, which is how an InsightShare, and that's how we got involved through the Breathe project. There's also activating the archives currently ongoing, reconnecting objects, African restitution project. There's a fair few, so we're very excited to share this particular one with you here today.
My name is Whitney, I'm from the Vienna group, and I will give you a brief introduction to our first video. It is in regards to the Ekpo mask from the Ibibio tribe in Nigeria, and we hope for it to deepen your understanding of the traditional use of masks and traditions, pre-colonialism and Christianity, with the help of educator from the African school, Nati Mark Samuels, who is here today. Yeah, well,
without further ado, here is the goes.
Like the sun from the sky, the history of my ancestors has been stolen. A mask that trapped in the museum made my heart broken. More than 100 years never spoke a word, but the eyes were speaking, saying they took every precious thing from us, but our freedom can't be taken. It's not only about the space. I hate being in this cage. Tell my people that I don't want to be here. I'm dying in this place. Tell the world that they're missing the main point. Tell them my people are still suffering. And this is the case.
Okay, my name is Natty Mark Samuels, and I'm an educator. In 2009, I set up the African School, because when we look at Oxford, there's a real dearth of provision concerning African studies. So the university, Oxford University, only offers it at a master's level. Brooks doesn't offer it. Abner and Whitney doesn't offer it. The City College doesn't offer it. So it became my kind of self-imposed remit to make sure that there's African studies for the general community.
And I'll be introducing the next film. The tusk that we studied specifically is a damaged ivory tusk from the Benin Kingdom, from the Edo people, which is in present-day Nigeria, was stolen and arraigned in 1897 by British colonizers. Usually this is referred to as a punitive mission. It's a raid. And it lies in the first floor of the Pitt Rivers Museum with a few other stolen objects from that time period, from that specific raid. We interviewed Wagbale Edward Ekpo, who is a researcher and journalist from Nigeria. He joined us via Zoom. And Ashley, apologies, Ashley, if you're here, I'm saying Kutu wrong, all right? But she's a researcher at the Pitt Rivers Museum and also helped us contextualize the objects. I also wanted to clarify, because we don't define these terms in the film, within Edo culture, the head monarch is called the Oba. It's the king of the Benin Kingdom. And we also refer to the Ioba, who is the queen mother in the Benin Kingdom. And with that, enjoy.
The ivory tusk. It's not an object. It is not an artifact. It is not art. Although it merges the inhuman and cruel legacy of this colonial world, this ivory tusk belongs to the royals. To the royals you don't know, but you should.
The purpose of the carved ivory tusk in Benin tradition is to commemorate a dead Oba.
The objects from the Oba's palace, which were taken during the Benin expedition of 1897, are often in Western sort of museums considered art objects. But we know, especially with the tusk, that it was part of the altarpiece. It was part of an important place of sort of worship for people, but it was also incredibly personal.
Introduction to tones of resistance. So guiding us towards an understanding of the mbira in this film, our cultural specialists, Thabo, Malaya, and Miles Nube. Thabo is a volunteer at the Multica project with the Pitt Rivers and a fantastic storyteller. Miles is a spirit medium and plays the mbira as part of his practice. With them, we have learned what the mbira is, but also what it is not. Despite what the Pitt River's original display might say, it is not just one variety of Jew's harp, a category with which the display comfortably erases the specific cultural importance of similar instruments, ranging from Africa through Asia and the Pacific. The mbira has been played traditionally by the Shona since at least the Iron Age, to appease the spirits and bring rain. It is part of the ecology of the land, made of natural and agricultural materials that link its players and their communities inextricably to their land. It is not from Rhodesia. It is also not a thumb piano. Holding it right for the first time with both thumbs and the right index finger positioned over or under the correct keys and the right little finger inserted through the soundboard with a specific technique just as precise as, say, classical Spanish guitar, is said to be the mark of a natural born player. as you will see or hear, it has its own tuning, something which our team members and musical producers have had to grapple with, as I'm sure you will too. When this happens, remember that music cannot be a common language until we do the work to name and heal the assumptions and violences we carry with us. Just like everything else in this museum, we must really ask why we have them. Lastly, as Thabo and Miles show us, the mbira is resistance and identity through community, through war, and through pure joy.
Back in the day, people who played the mbira were called gwenyambira. Gwenyambira means to tickle the mbira. I first became aware of the musical instrument called mbira when I was young. My uncle used to live in the villages, so when he came to visit us in town, he used to bring the instrument and then he used to play it. It's an instrument that was used with mainly the Shona people for thousands of years. With this instrument, they used to play it mainly as a conduit to connect with the spiritual world. They also played the mbira when they wanted to appease the spirit so that they can have rains coming. They played the mbira when there was a funeral. They also played mbira, it's just to celebrate life. So these people, they had their connection with the spiritual world. So not everybody just picked up the mbira and played it. Before the advent of the missionaries, it was a day-to-day instrument that was used within the people. And then when the missionary came, they introduced Christianity. And then when Christianity came, they told the people, the natives of Zimbabwe, that the practice of spiritualism is devil worship. So anything that's connected with spiritualism, it was considered worshiping the devil.
So this film is about ongoing imperialism. I hope you enjoy.
He who does not ask questions learns nothing. So people sometimes say to me when I'm teaching, this question might sound silly, but no question is silly, is it? Because each question leads to more information.
Just to add to what my brother was saying, right, about these corporates, these big corporations. I mean, have a look at the Congo. It's been an ongoing war, I don't know for how decades, right? But the funny thing is, these people, they don't manufacture weapons.
Exactly.
But they have the most advanced weaponry. And who is giving them that? The weapons. African countries, they don't manufacture weapons.
They're not giving them.
It's an exchange.
They're selling them. And they have a loan for that will have to pay for.
Well, you know, the Congo is the most richest country in Africa, right? And what they do, right, where the mines are, they are heavily fortified. They have planes that fly in, fly out. Fly in, fly out, you know? Why do they do this? They say, just keep them fighting each other. We'll just take their resources.
So before we move on to our question and answer, we want to present you something special. So we had the honor to work with Kemma, who is sadly not with us here today, and Kingsley, who's right there, to produce and write a spoken word / musical piece. So basically what we did was write our feelings down on the topics that we have discussed this past week. And we also had the opportunity to work with different kinds of instruments. We recorded our raps, spoken word pieces. Yeah, again, if you have any questions, comments, opinions, please feel free to voice them afterwards.
There's nothing new about colonialism. Nothing's changed but the symbolism. Giving millions but taking trillions. Talking about giving back but we're only getting back trinkets. Two wings, one bird. Goons control both sides. Conquer and divide. Time to bring the truth to light. Our enemies connive. Wolves with a sheep's hide. I can see through their lies. Their handouts are a guise to bring about our demise. 100, give 5, they can apologize, but I will not be satisfied until I see my people rise. I will not be satisfied until I see my people rise. I will not be satisfied until I see my people rise. We all realize that real killers wear ties.
Waves crashing on the stones and rocks. Sounds like an
Well, thank you everyone for joining us today. So you can either walk around the museum or join us in a Q&A. And we would like to extend our thanks to our facilitators and our interviewees before the next section. So to Nati, Wagbale, Ashley, Thabo, Miles, Samuel, Kema and Kingsley, we sincerely appreciate your time and generosity and energy that you have blessed us with for this project.
Objective of the project is a cultural exchange between different cities, different museums, connecting people of color and participatory art projects, essentially. Usually in this, in our case, we were studying stolen art, which was a way for people of many different backgrounds to sort of learn about their ancestral history and then to use creative media to sort of relay the knowledge and information that we learned.
People get very focused on the product. And like we talked about learning skills, but also what's opened up in spaces like this is a chance to have conversations about the really, really hard stuff. Especially after COVID, it's been 2 years. You know, most of your interactions with the stuff which really gets your adrenaline pumping, really makes you scared, it's here, it's on a phone or on a computer. Mm-hmm. And the chances to form a space where you can develop ideas, where you can develop argumentation, where you can see that people are actually really feeling this in their core and actually having people let it out, mm-hmm. It's an amazing space for praxis. And having people who experience so much more come and contain that and guide it is fantastic as well. So it's about the process of going through it as much as the product.
So I just wanted to know why the I don't know how to pronounce it, sorry.
Mbira.
Not Mbira, Mbira.
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 Okay. Well done. Well. Mm-hmm. I wanted to know why it was disregarded and lost in the culture.
When Zimbabwe was colonized, the missionaries they came over and then they told us that you cannot be who you are as a people. So they say for you to control a person, you have to strip them, you have to strip them off their belief systems. So that's when they brought in Christianity. So hence we have our names like Peter, John, you know, that's when you're baptized. So we had a self-loathing of ourselves because they said whatever you believed in as a Shona person or as an African person, That's irrelevant, you see. So the only way to go to Msigawano or to go to God is through Jesus Christ, through the missionaries. So hence, anyone who played the mirror, he was associated with devil worship.
So just really as a follow-on question, it made it sound as if there was a disconnect in the tradition. In this case of playing, what model, was there still a thread there? Were there still practitioners? Were there people there to help resurrect this as a living tradition?
The families, specific families that would have been making the mbira for generations, say at least 800 years, plus the, for example, the Tirikotis, the Tirikoti family is very popular in Zimbabwe. They make various types of mbiras that cover all different parts of Zimbabwe. They are given that role because they've been channeling mbira making for thousands of years, so no one kind of tries to take it over because we see it as a talent collectively, as a family, and you have to be gifted to play the mbira. You have to be gifted to carve it, to be able to, you don't have to go to university for it, but you have to channel the powers that used to make the mbira. So in lots of instances, you'd find that like someone's great-grandfather was a mbira maker, and then 100 years later, I come through as the mbira player today because of the people that were playing mbira in my lineage from my dad's side. I didn't have to go to university, I just went by the sea, sat with the waves like coming up to here, and I just started playing.
It's being taught in schools. It was even before, within our curricula, the mbira wasn't even allowed to be taught in school. Mm-hmm. Not even allowed to learn about our own history. You know, up until after independence, now some of the schools now they are teaching, you know, within the music classes, they're teaching kids to play the mbira. So they understand the instrument as just an instrument without the attachment within our spirituality. So even at home, most parents they feel so uncomfortable when
to attach the spiritual
aspect to the with the instrument. You see, because of all we talk about the Christianity. So like you look at now, like in Africa, there's more, you know, African people, they're more Christians than vis-a-vis when you come to Europe. When you come to these churches here in England, people don't go to church. You know? But us now, we'll be given that task of saying, hallelujah, you know, thank you, Jesus, you know. So, yeah, which is a bit, I find it quite interesting. Why, you know, these people who gave us the religion, now they've moved away from the religion. Yeah. And now we're the ones who are perpetuating and actually walking towards and say, there's Jesus Christ there, who is there. But what about our own history? What about our own history that we've forgotten? Because we're taught to hate it. Mm-hmm. But now we need to rise it, you know, for you to come back and say, yes, we are proud to be who we are.
One of the takeaways of this experience was some sort of healing from trauma, from school times and stuff like that, where I was one of the few black children, and now to be in this almost classroom setting, but with people that share same beliefs, same experiences, went through the same trauma, even though they are not from the same country, was very healing and helpful. And I think I will take quite a lot of this with me, just as strength and energy to bring back to Austria to do more cultural work that helps other people to gain the strength that this project also gave me.
What's happening in our community? Why did they feel like ownership? Why did they cut our voices? Freedom to trust in our choices. What's happening in our community? Why did they feel like ownership? Why did they cut out our voices? Freedom to trust in our choices.